news.
I'm engaged.
I can't go to my little sister's wedding single.
Got 30 days and 30,000 miles.
I want you to have these cranberry flavored for the holidays.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to What the Flick. Ben Mankiewicz, Christy Lemire, Alonzo Duralde. Alonzo didn't see the movie we're going to talk about right now because, fucking typical excuse, I was in Kosovo.
That old song.
Yeah.
I'm always in Kosovo.
You missed Baggage Claim.
Oh, my God. Did you miss Baggage Claim?
More's the pity, alas, from what I hear.
So, Baggage Claim, Christy, is the story of what?
This is the story of a flight attendant played by Paula Patton, who for some reason, despite looking like Paula Patton, cannot find a date. And her entire raison d'etre is to find a husband in the next 30 days so she can get engaged before her little sister gets married. It's a very wholesome and heartwarming story and a great message for young girls out there. Take a look.
One of your exes is on a flight from Los Angeles to Houston.
Montana.
Langston.
Montana.
Curtis.
Dang it!
This ain't my house. It's hers. I can't afford this.
Open that damn door!
She crazy.
Open, 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 open!
I told you she crazy. Crazy, she crazy! Nobody move! I have no life, which gives me all day to ruin yours!
So yeah, the conceit of the 30-day time limit before her little sister, who's like a sophomore in college, mm-hmm. marries the stud running back mm-hmm. on the team, is so artificially contrived that you don't even quite recognize it as the plot device.
Like why is she getting married in 30 days?
Like, why is she getting married? Why is she suddenly getting married in 30 days? Why does Paula Patton have to find a fiance in those
Maybe
30
days?
Maybe
she has to.
No, it's not even like that old fashioned, a whole other way.
That would make it interesting. So when they start the clock, they're like day 30, you know, and the montage begins. I'm like, day 30 of what? Yeah. Like, I didn't even know what they were
and
referencing.
Rehearsal dinner, because she right. had to make a big
announcement. I got it later. I figured it out.
Rehearsal dinner. So apparently, like, Paula Patton's character has dated every hot black actor in Hollywood.
Yes,
you
she
have,
has.
You have, Jaimin Hunsu, you have Taye Diggs.
Her friend, who she hasn't dated, Derek Luke.
Derek Luke is her best friend down the hall, who of course is going to be the one who's really meant for her all this time, and is right under her nose.
You did see
right,
it.
Right, right. She has the obligatory, promiscuous, wisecracking best friend, played by Jill Scott.
Played by Jill Scott. So here's another great thing about what's so silly about this movie. So Jill Scott plays her wisecracking best friend, her sort of sexually liberated wisecracking best friend, whose name in the script is Gail Best, in case you missed that she's the best friend.
In case you're wondering.
And you know from just our description of it that she ends up with Derek Luke.
Also, every black woman's best friend is named Gail.
And her, but who is the her friend who lives down the hall? Remember, she's looking for a husband. His name is William Wright.
No, making him. No.
We didn't pick up on it until like toward the end. Yeah. There was some reference to Mr. Wright.
Right. Yeah. Oh, delay.
No.
Yeah.
Mr.
Yeah.
Wright.
See, he's Mr. Wright. Yeah.
I'm going back to Kosovo.
Where there are no bad movies.
No, I'm sure.
Adam Scott plays Adam Brody, plays another flight attendant friend, and he's gay, and it's amazing that his name isn't Sam Gay.
But he's actually,
he's funny.
I kind of like Adam Brody as the
his character
sassy gay friend.
Is moderately believable, and he is has the best, the timing is good. He's funny.
He's dialing it down in a way that nobody else in this
That's
movie
right,
is.
Yeah.
There's, I mean, Paula Patton, as gorgeous as she is, and you leaned over to me at one point, and you were like, damn, she is pretty. But she's doing this weird kind of twitchy thing with her face where she's like, she's like gesturing and wildly gesticulating with her face
and
at all times.
And the voice is like this forced
raspiness
in it that seemed like, you know, and she's always running. She's late to catch, to make the flight, to get to Detroit, to accidentally meet the friend who's on that flight, everyone's working. And so she's running for the airport constantly. Running like, racing.
Her bag behind her back. She's a fly attendant. Yeah. How to use a roller
totally, yeah.
Apparently. She's like, anyway, so she has this twist and she go off. This is a spoiler. Does she either have a life of like excitement and passion with Jaimin Hunsu, who is this hotel magnate? Or does she stay and have a quiet home and maybe some kids with Derek Luke, who's been her childhood best friend? What would you choose? This is a conundrum presented to her and to us. There is one funny bit in the entire movie, and that is that Taye Diggs, one of her ex-boyfriends, is this black Republican running for Congress.
Yes.
And the perfect politician's wife that she has to pretend to be and cannot be any longer. It's the only thing that is vaguely funny in this movie.
Yeah, at one point toward the end when she rejects Taye Diggs, she's like, yeah, I don't even know. I don't trust black Republicans.
Yeah. She said, like, I wouldn't even vote for you.
Yeah, I wouldn't even vote for you.
So there's a couple of funny things, but this is insulting. It's like every bad archaic cliche about how women feel the need to define themselves. It could have been made like 60 years ago.
Totally.
How does this movie still get made today? I'm confused.
It sounds exactly like that terrible Anna Faris movie.
What's Your Number?
What's Your Number?
Is she looking for a husband too?
She decides that some magazine article says, you know, you're supposed to sleep with like 27 men before you get married or something, and she's at number 26, and so she goes on this furious thing to like check with all the exes and figure out which one was the right one, and of course it's the friend across the hall, blah, whatever, you know. Exactly, yeah.
Ugh. Yeah, it turns out that we've reached a complete racial equality when it comes to making shitty, pointless romantic comedies.
Yes.
It's bad and it's super dull and there's no edge to it. That even sounds like it, I didn't see that, but it sounds like at least it had the idea that she slept with 26 guys. Like there's just this innocence to it. Who's the other dude she dated?
Boris Kojo.
Is that the Derek Diesel guy?
No, that's Trey Songz.
This is
Boris Kojo is the guy she's dating at the beginning.
Oh, right, who turns out to have the family.
Right, and she goes snooping in his window, because we all do that. We all hide in trash cans to snoop in people's
windows. Snooping in the window, moving her arms and
gesticulating. And then does she fall?
She falls.
She does.
It makes a lot of noise.
Oh, my God.
Go, hello.
But she hides in the trash can.
In the trash can. But one of the main examples of bad green screen in this movie, like when they're sitting in the car, but also like when they're on a boat in Chicago in November.
Thanksgiving.
late
November.
It's fucking cold.
Yeah, right. No, it's...
No, it's bad.
Yeah, there's a lot wrong with it. I went with a 2. It's just a waste of time. Mm-hmm. It's not mean. It's just a total waste of time.
It's not mean, but it's insulting.
It isn't right regarding women. This notion that she's 30, she's gorgeous, she doesn't have to meet anybody right now. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it sends a silly, stupid message. So
I gave it a 2.5 because I did laugh at the Taye Diggs stuff. So.
Yeah, that was the best part. And what's his name? Adam, not Scott.
Adam Brody.
Sorry. Yes. 2.3 overall for Baggage Claim.
It's 7% on Rotten Tomatoes. One person likes this movie.
Yeah, so. Hard to believe. Don't see it. Mm-hmm.